Hello, everyone. Welcome to the GameKraft GameKast on GamerAccess.com. I'm your host, Bronson Fiore, joined by the ever awesome Aaron Reynolds.
Woo!
Oh, thank you. That's nice.
Oh, gosh.
How you doing, Bronson?
I'm doing good. So we're going back to the oldest of old school, just me and you podcasting for the week. Because the intern is busy doing intern things, so it's just us.
Hey, you know?
Yeah.
Wonder if any old fans remember the old days.
The good old days.
Thankfully, I was not part of the old days when we were doing the Rock Band mic thing.
Oh, God. Yeah.
It was a good time.
Good times.
But... Oh, God, I remember podcasting in your hot-ass bedroom.
Yeah,
the car is going by. That was nice.
I also remember podcasting in my current bedroom in the summer. Guess what? It's still a billion degrees. Actually, this bedroom still gets, like, really warm when we have more than two people, like, even during the winter.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, during the winter, we'll straight up have, like, four or five people in here for a recording, just like, ah, damn, it's warm. Like we had the New Year's party here.
Oh, jeez. At your house?
Yeah.
Man.
Well, yeah, we've completely cleaned out the living room, so.
Oh, right. Okay, yep.
I don't have people living in it anymore, so.
Jeez.
I sleep in the living room. That's all that really goes on there.
Right. Okay.
So
cool.
Anyway, we had a bunch of people playing SingStar and Rock Band and the and like they just the room got warm enough to the point where we had to open a window in like early January, late December. So that should tell you that this house stays warm.
SingStar's hot and heavy.
It is any other way. Yep. We actually just had Jordan had her bachelorette party here because no one else was willing to host.
Oh.
And we played SingStar, and yeah, SingStar always brings out the best in humanity. Truly.
You would hope.
Anyway,
I've seen some horrors, man.
Yeah, we've seen some magical things over the past. Let's say I got that game in 2009, so the past 7 years of SingStar.
Jesus.
Not a fan of the newest version that they have, though.
No.
No, I kind
What's
of.
What's wrong?
It's just mainly the way the interface works. I'm not a fan.
Oh, okay, but you know the songs and all that still.
Yeah, still great.
Okay.
And I liked how they carried all the shit that you bought on their store over to the PS4. That was cool.
Yeah, that's great.
But
you didn't play SingStar this week, did you?
I did actually. That was last. Oh. This was the pat. Like, that's why we had to move the GameKast. Actually, it was Jordan's bachelorette party.
Oh, all right. So, was it fun?
Yeah, it was a good time. We. Jordan was willing to pay for $20 worth of new music to add on to it. So
he's paying at her own bachelorette party.
Ray and I bought booze, so I mean.
You know. Oh, okay. Well, then, yeah, perfect.
Ray, Anthony, Danny, and I all bought booze. So
nice.
Yeah.
Well, cool.
So
yeah. What else did you play?
Let's see. I also hopped into more Street Fighter.
Oh, God. Okay.
Not much new to report other than if I ever take more than a two-day break from that game, I come back and instantly still have all my bad habits.
What's that?
Sorry, go ahead.
Did you see the trailer for the live-action video series thing for Street Fighter?
No, I have not.
I just saw it trending today as of this recording of like live action Street Fighter characters looks like it was being hosted by Machinima. Or no, that, Machinima was reporting on it, and it was like, it's only on that, it can only be seen on that app Go90 or whatever that was getting pushed real hard during the VGAs.
Okay, great.
But yeah, there's a great picture of just like Ken looking like Ken-ass Ken with a Bluetooth because he's an agent too. I don't know, it's whatever.
Okay, that's cool.
That's great. It's great.
I'm looking forward to that new character being out in the next week or so. I'm always stoked to like, because man, that game is fun, but it like, I'm finally starting to get burnt out on online matches, I guess.
Really?
Unless I get like a really good like, and I think part of it's just I haven't had a lot of time recently because I've been working a lot of OT.
Sure.
So, like. It's really hard to stay focused on getting better and whatnot, but goddamn, the fighting is so good. The game looks good. The music's great. Just, ugh. Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's the worst time to not be into online mode is when they're in the stage of release where they only have pretty much the online mode.
But yeah, I hopped into the Division.
Okay.
Yeah, I played all weekend and then immediately returned it on Monday.
Alright, so and, do we have a final verdict?
I got to level, I think, 10, around there. I got to try most of what the game is all about. And man, they made a very interesting version of Destiny.
What kind of interesting are we talking here?
It's... You know, they
You're talking like man sitting on the sidewalk, like wearing his pants on his head, kind of interesting.
Well, kind of, because it's like, okay, you guys made Destiny, but the shooting isn't as good. The fiction isn't half as good, because it's like, what can all the bosses for this game be? Just dudes. Just different types of dudes. Like, you can't, it's not like Destiny where you could have just like, oh yeah, we made this like giant T-Rex alien. Yeah, so, or like, you know, World of Warcraft, where it's just like, yeah, here's a dragon that, like, spawns giant tentacle dragons. Yeah, you know, like, stuff like that.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I think the game is really hindered by its setting. And then the rest of it is just like they made a really solid loot shooter. Then the end game is just kind of the Dark Zone right now. And then, like, the world itself isn't that interesting to be in. It's really boring.
Jeez.
Yeah, so... I will say, though, the PvP is incredible.
Like, really?
The PvP is one of my favorite PvPs in, like, any game ever.
What?
I will explain. So, right. Have you heard about the Dark Zone?
Yes.
Okay, the Dark Zone's this big area where it's like everyone versus everyone. You can go and get loot, and like you like, but like the thing is, anybody can come and fuck up your day. So you always right. have to be cautious, otherwise you have all your shit stolen. And just like I've seen like people just like leaving each other alone, letting each other kill bosses. I've seen people just straight up wait for other groups to get into encounters, ice them, and steal their shit. When they're weakened. I've seen, like, one of my favorites was this one where it was just, like, and this was a video, so I didn't see this one first, and the other ones I did. It was, like, a group of, like, 10 people dancing around this thing they just beat, and they got all the loot for, and this dude throws a grenade into it, kills them all, and takes all of their shit.
God.
It's a Mexican standoff at all times in the Dark Zone. It's just like everyone Jesus. Is super fucking paranoid. Everyone is just like you'll like if you are by yourself and like three people surround you, you are just shitting your pants. Like even if three people just walk by you to go take care of their own business, it's just like okay, I gotta keep an eye on them. Otherwise, they're gonna fucking pop me. Like I've seen people get robbed. Like I'd play the game with like two friends, and there'd be a guy solo and like four dudes going up to him, and just like drop your shit. You know?
What the fuck?
Yeah.
I don't know. That doesn't sound fun to me. I think maybe for some people.
It's damn. Well, like,
it reminds me of the DayZ slave thing.
Well, so I would say just like roll in a group of three people, like you and two other people, and most people aren't going to mess with you.
Well, like, sure.
If you go into that solo, like, you are not going to have a good time in most cases. Unless you're like, I went into it solo, but I was super careful to stay hidden most of the time. One of the things that I'm not super proud of this, but, like, these guys, I saw these guys, like, kill another squad. And then just, like, I trailed them without them noticing, waiting for them to get weak in an encounter, and I iced them all. I'm just like, justice, I am the Dark Zone Batman. It's wildly entertaining, the Dark Zone stuff. It's just, that's the only part of the game that I really had a lot of fun with.
That's just not enough to...
Yeah,
like it's okay.
Yeah, like the rest of the game is fine. It's a competent loot shooter, but then like you get that Dark Zone. It's just this wild. It's just it's the Wild West. It's just fucking like people are robbing each other. People are ignoring each other. Yeah, like I literally just went in there and I just saw like three groups of people just all walk by each other because they didn't want to deal with the Mexican standoff bullshit. Yeah. I've straight up like seen dudes who are just like shoot on sight. The second they see you, they start popping off. Oh,
Jesus Christ! Wow.
So
it sounds crazy.
Yeah, like I didn't get that far because I just wasn't that interested in the game. And also because we run 60-minute access through our GameFly account. At the Gamer Access, so I had to return it to get another game that comes out today. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. But yeah, like that's. I see why people are digging it. I see why it's doing all these sales numbers and why people enjoy it. But like the entire time, I'm like thinking, like, man, I'd rather be playing The Taken King right now.
Jeez.
I think there's some things Destiny could learn from them, but I also think that there's a lot of things that they could learn from Destiny. So, and there's a lot of things that both those games could learn from World of Warcraft. So, yeah.
Fair enough.
So I played some of the Division. As always, been into Heroes of the Storm. I know that Heroes of the Storm, like, I had an extra Grave Shift this week and an extra Swing Shift, and that's the game I used past time on it. And okay. I finally got to the point of getting a little burnt out on the game. So, there's that.
Yeah,
which makes sense, because I've been playing the game for, like, a year and a half straight. Because I was in the alpha and in the beta and in the full release.
That's fair.
So yeah, but, and then the last game I played, or the last two games I played were two old ones, Burnout Paradise.
Okay. Yep.
I was bored on Grave Shift. I got the cleaning done and I was just like, what's on my Steam library that I actually have installed right now? And I saw Burnout Paradise and I'm like, why not? And I like...
I got on one night and I swear I saw you playing that and I spent like a second. I thought, like, good choice. Yep. Good on you. And then moved on to my game.
You're making good decisions.
I was like, I think it was when I was, it may have been when I tried to play, started playing Stardew Valley and I looked at you playing Burnout Paradise like, I don't know if this game's going to be good, but most likely you're making the better choice here.
We'll get to Stardew Valley in a minute.
Yeah, we will in a minute.
Because I actually really want to talk about that game because I've been getting a lot of hype and I've actually been really wanting to play it because I loved Animal Crossing.
Sure. So, yeah. But yeah, Burnout Paradise. That was a good choice. It's always a good choice.
Yeah, so yeah, because my PC save is still relatively fresh. I just wish I was playing with a controller, not a keyboard and mouse.
Yeah.
That said, like, that just gives me an excuse to bring a controller to work. But, I was just having a blast with it, man. Like, I was having a lot of fun. Just driving around, crashing through billboards, like. Like, every time I see a billboard, like, it just instantly becomes this puzzle I have to solve. It's like, how do I get up there to smash that billboard?
Oh, and it's so good. Yeah. They have the licensing system. So you go through the grades, and then you also have, yeah, you have to go through the glowing, I don't know, they would block off, yeah, they would block off roadways.
Yeah, like the little glowing things
you had to knock down. Yep.
They
gave you all these collectibles in a racing game.
Not only that, but like just the satisfaction of like when you're in a race and like you knock someone around and it says takedown. Like it slows the crash down.
I mean,
it just feels,
you know,
so good.
They've had that down since Burnout. They have that shit down. Like, yeah. Paradise, yeah. It's still good, and no one's really doing it that way.
After an hour and a half of it, I just got sad because I was just like, so this came out in January. It's been 8 years and 2 months since the last Burnout.
God.
Real bummer.
I mean, I know they're doing Need for Speed or whatever. That's fine.
Nobody cares about Need for Speed. Make another, like, I remember Jeff Gerstmann over at Giant Bomb wrote an article about, like, franchises he wants to see come back. And, like, it got to Burnout. It says, come fucking on already.
I mean, Jesus Christ, they were so good. The Black Box games, Burnout Paradise, or another Burnout and another Skate. They're both great,
yeah,
fantastic.
Yeah, like the Criterion
games.
Like, just, yeah. God damn. Like, I would settle for Burnout Paradise, like, just remastered. Just give me an excuse to play through it a fucking again.
No, all they do, they've just released the same game, but they just moved all the billboards around. Okay.
Like, you know, like, if they just said, hey, we're putting it out on PS4 and Xbox One, making it prettier, and it'll have all the DLC packed in, I'll be like, great! Gonna play this for the game for the fourth and fifth time, I see.
Right.
Just so unbelievably satisfying. Like, everything about it's super satisfying, super fun. Oh. So, yeah, I dug into that, and I dug into Ocarina of Time for the 3DS.
Okay.
So, we've been recording our Let's Play of Ocarina of Time. It should launch either the same week this podcast, or next week. And I just, like, watching Ray play it made me want to go, okay, I'm going to make my own save on the 3DS and, like try and match our pace or do better than it. And I'm at the Forest Temple, and, man, the 3DS version of that game is way, 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 way better looking. Like, so much better looking. Like, you look at the N64 version, you're like, yeah, it looks all right for its, you know, for its day. Like, it looks pretty good for its day. And, you know, and I, sorry, I load up the 3DS version, I'm like, oh, this opening menu looks a lot prettier, and, like, I looked at Kokiri Forest, I'm like, wow, they have hands, they have, like, full faces. There's not, like, everything's not super blurry, because it's not an N64 game anymore. So there's that. And then, hey, can we talk about how action-adventure game design for the past, like, two decades all come from that game?
We can talk about that. I mean, it comes up every time we talk about it in a greatest games of all time discussion.
Yeah. Like, just, man, it just the puzzles, the way the dungeons work, the way that, like, it has narrative progression, like, that game is the root of so much, and it's still a blast to play. Like, yeah, there's some parts of it that are, like, weird and kind of archaic, but for the most part, game's awesome. So, but yeah, yeah, like, and then watching me play it versus watching Ray play it is hilarious. Like, just like, because I played through that game a bunch as a kid, and like once or twice as a teenager, and then like twice during college. So I was fairly experienced with the game. Versus watching Ray play it, who's never played a Zelda game ever. Like, he has never played a Zelda game.
Yeah.
And watching him play it for the first time, and have this be his first one, and it's the N64 version, just, you know, being emulated on a Wii U.
Right.
It's been an adventure. To say the least. Just like... like, Chelsea and I have been playing it with him last week, and, like, we're just trying to tell him, no, go here, no, do this, why are you doing that? also, his general surprise, like, how surprised he is at some things is entertaining.
No, oh, really?
Yeah, but from what I can tell, he's really liking the game. Because, I mean, we did, like, an hour and a half recording session, went to grab lunch, recorded an hour of The Division, and he's like, yo, can we do more Zelda? So, I think that's a good sign.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Any questions on any of that?
No, I have no questions on Ocarina of Time. Yeah. They have been talked about and talked about.
You know, 30th anniversary of Zelda.
Yeah, Zelda. Yeah. That new one's coming out.
Hopefully.
Maybe. Depending on... it depends on what console that it's coming out on. I don't even...
it's, yeah, we'll just... I actually did my soapbox on how, with their new console, Nintendo just needs to just not be weird and just... do a normal system with a normal ass controller.
Did you see that controller picture earlier this week?
No, I did not. What's up?
It's supposedly a picture of the new Nintendo NX controller. Let me see if I can.
Oh god, what's it of? Try and describe to me before I see this thing.
Remember the patent. Remember the patent was the controller was the screen.
Okay.
And it is very much looking exactly like the patent, where there's two joysticks, there are a couple buttons you can identify, and the entire controller pretty much is the screen. And it looks like a people are saying we should be wary of it because it looks exactly like the patent design that was released months ago, and usually that doesn't happen. Usually it's changed a little bit. But it looks weird. I like that they're trying to do new ideas, but I don't know if this is a good one.
Alright, open it now.
Are you opening it up? Okay.
Alright, guys, Nintendo's doomed. Let's... pack this shit in, because fucking.
I don't know if that's the final design of that controller or not.
Okay,
I don't know.
So,
I think this is their solution for the controller that also attaches to a console but is also a portable device.
For those of you who are like listening to this, like, you know, for those of you listening, I'll describe this to you. So it's an elongated oval with two analog sticks, and then the rest of it is a fucking screen. With what looks like a camera and some buttons at the top. And a charger at the bottom. What the fuck?
I don't know if that's top or bottom.
Okay, it's... okay. I see the diagram. That's actually the bottom. What
okay,
the
yeah.
fuck?
It's crazy.
What?
Look at how much screen on the side is going to be covered up by your hands.
What the fuck is Nintendo thinking? Look, Nintendo.
I think it's cool, but in a dumb way, not a good business way.
Not want to buy one way, like
unless it's cheap, man. But I don't see that being cheap.
Like Nintendo, I said it during my soapbox. This is what you need to do because there's about 4 years left in this console generation, 4 to 5, because they're selling exceptionally well. You need to go and make a box
This.
You need to make a box that connects to the internet, and you have an account system, and you download fucking games, and everything's linked to your account. And it has a normal fucking controller. Not a tablet. Not a remote. Not a screen. Not a like, just a fucking controller. You know? Like the GameCube, or the God forbid N64, or the Super
Dude,
Nintendo.
Dude, that Wii U Pro controller is the nicest controller I've ever felt.
Yeah, like, it's great. It's wonderful. Like, that thing is awesome.
But it's not packaged with the game, and you can't play certain games because you have to have that tablet in the middle for some of them, like Splatoon. I would love to play Splatoon with my Pro.
You can't play Splatoon with a Pro controller?
Not that I checked. I was using Jerry's controller.
What do you need the tablet for in that game?
There's some, for some of the abilities in the game, you have to aim or like tap the map.
Oh, okay.
You know, like, oh, I need to shoot a missile in this part of the map, and then you tap it. And then, so to make sure that all that stuff works, they make that mandatory.
Nintendo has the strongest first party lineup in all of video games. Like, they have easily the strongest. Like, I look at the first party games I own on every console. I'm like, Xbox, it's like Killer Instinct, Halo, the rare stuff, that's about it. Forza. On my PS4, it's Infamous, Last of Us, Bloodborne. On my Wii U, it's like Zelda, Smash, Mario Kart, Donkey Kong, Wonderful 101, Bayonetta. And so, okay, out of the exclusives, Nintendo easily wins that fight, but Nintendo doesn't have Destiny, Rock Band, Metal Gear, Batman, you know, like, any of these big-ass titles. And I think, like, you know, I probably wouldn't have bought a PS4 at launch or an Xbox One in its first couple months if my Wii U, which I bought before any of the others, actually had those games on it. You know,
I don't know.
And, like, Nintendo is just so averse to having, God forbid, a normal fucking controller with a, like, online system that makes fucking sense and, you know, just the hell.
They always seem to be trying to push things to the next level, and they were successful with the SNES going from the NES controller. Did not succeed with the 64 controller.
The 64 succeeded really very much with the... You know, the 64 succeeded for the time.
Well, I mean, it worked for the time. But, like, it's not remembered fondly.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's
it was like this is, like, our first time experiencing 3D. I mean, obviously, alongside with the PlayStation, if you're not a PC gamer... Especially if you're young. You're, like, super-duper young in a Nintendo household. This is your first 3D experience for you. You would put up with a controller like that.
Like, the GameCube had a great controller. Like, GameCube controller was great.
You know, it's still weird. But it's one of the least weird of their recent controllers.
It's, like, it's still fucking a bunch of buttons and with two analog sticks. Like, the triggers were
right, but
weird.
They're, like, misshapen and tight sticks, and there's two shoulder buttons on one and one shoulder button on the other.
Like, it was made, I feel like it was made for Nintendo games, and, like, every other game is just kinda, you
well,
know,
that's
just
why that's, why, that's why you have all the controllers designed weird, because they're designing it for their own first party people.
Yeah, but, like, the problem is, though, is, like, all those games work fine on a fucking normal controller. Because, like, almost every Nintendo exclusive on the Wii U has, like, been adapted for the Pro controller also. Like, Splatoon is this weird outlier, which I'm not even sure if that's 100%. I'm gonna check. But, yeah, so...
I don't know. Yeah, that controller is a thing. Although, you know, that's not, obviously it's not 100% confirmed, but that matches the patent. I don't know what they're looking at on the screen.
Okay, so apparently the Classic and the Pro controller work with the Splatoon.
Well, I'll have to check that out then, because...
Yeah, so...
That's odd. Alright.
So we'll have to look into that, but...
Then I can enjoy that game again.
Yeah, great, yeah. I just bought Donkey Kong with my last check, and I'm gonna enjoy playing that game with, you know, because that game supports the gamepad, the Wiimote nunchuck, and the Pro Controller. That's another problem with the Wii U is just like it supports every fucking controller under the sun. Like the only time that was ever beneficial was with Smash. Like 8-player Smash, getting 8 controllers for 8-player Smash, it makes it super easy. Because I have 4 GameCube controllers and a gamepad. That's 5 players. And then I have a Wiimote, and I have 2 Wiimotes and nunchucks. So that's 7. And then I have a 3DS. So that's 8.
Right.
But God, getting that all, like getting 8-player Smash set up is just like, I feel like a goddamn rocket scientist. Like it's just like I'm connecting all these cables. I have all these different remotes.
It's wires. They kind of suck.
Yeah, I wish they would have like made that GameCube adapter like for 8 controllers and 8 GameCube controllers could have worked. I probably would have bought like 4 extra GameCube controllers for Smash Bros.
I just don't know how much they would have sold, because how many games would actually utilize 8 players?
But then make it so I can just buy a second one, you know, and have it
work. Yeah, there's that.
But I don't know, but like, I don't know why Nintendo doesn't make it so fucking GameCube controllers can work with at least all of their games. You know, but whatever. But like, Nintendo makes some incredible games. Like, I loved Mario. Like, it said, you know, said before, say it again. It says that I played 32 straight hours of Mario 3D World and still love it. You know, it says a lot that about that game. And there's a lot of games like that Nintendo has. Like, I love Donkey Kong Tropical Freeze and Smash and Twilight Princess HD and Wind Waker HD and Mario U, and they have all these really awesome games, but they don't have any support with that, and their console is still as expensive as the other consoles.
It's a pain. I don't know. I'm hoping they'll turn it around with this one, but that controller definitely Nintendo if that's their controller.
I want to love you, Nintendo. Why do you make it so hard?
You gotta work for Nintendo's love.
What, Senpai, why don't you notice me?
Jeez.
Anyway. So what you been playing?
Oh, you know what? I've been playing some video games recently. I didn't play a lot of video games all year last year. To the point where I only had like 3 games or something like that in my top 10 that I've just habitually have been doing, despite the fact that I haven't officially been required to make a top 10. Just do that now. The effects of this website. Anyway. Been playing a lot of games, starting with Stardew Valley.
Okay, yeah, let's talk about that game. So that's the Harvest Moon style thing that...
Apparently.
That's the game that is basically Harvest Moon, from what I've been hearing. And it's an indie game, and yeah, tell me about that, because Tori has been playing a ton of it, our staff artist. And I've been hearing a lot of good things, and I threw it up on my Steam wish list, because like I had the money to buy a Ryu amiibo or this game, and I went for the amiibo. So tell me about it.
Oh, really? Okay, well, let me pull this up here real quick. Wait, why is that? Okay, Stardew Valley. Yeah, you have a grandfather who owns a farm. Gives you a letter, tells you not to open it until, I don't know, you're down on life, and then
until what?
He dies.
You got out.
Until you get burnt out on life, I think, is what the sentiment was. And then grandfather dies, you go to work in the city, you get a city job at Joja Corporation, I think is what it's called. And you get bummed out, you open the letter, you own a farm. So you go down and you do some farm living. And from there, the game is basically just wandering around, doing your farming, and getting to know people. And lots of mining. There's a lot of mining in this farming game. But no, it's fun. You start out just farming, like, you know, 4 crops, 8 crops. You just keep building on that, trying to earn money. And then while you're doing that, there's all these different people. There's 28 people in the city. And you can get to know each and every one of them. And they have their own little routines and routes depending on the day and depending on the season. Some of them have stories going on. You have to go in and find out. I got to say, I'm not super far in. Like, I have not gotten to fall in the first year. It basically designates 1 month to each season. So 1 month of spring, summer, fall, winter.
You are just describing like Harvest Moon, like beat for beat. And I'm just getting super excited. So keep going.
I mean, that's basically what it is. I'm going to start up right now while I'm talking about it. You know, you customize your little dude. Oh, Jesus Christ. I have to say, the music, the sound effects, the visuals of this game are spot on.
Fantastic. Like, I'm looking at my friends list, and it's like you, Tori, and Stephanie are all playing it.
It's awesome. It's just great saving
for other things right now, but like, I'm looking at my Steam wish list, and you have me like contemplating this.
To Farmer Aaron, my knee's acting up again, and you know what helps? Rubbing the darn thing with hot pepper. What? I don't know what's up with him. Anyway, so this game's weird, but it's a lot of fun. And I guess, you know, I'd never played Harvest Moon is my problem, so I can't really tell you it's Harvest Moon with any authority. But
I really loved Animal Crossing. Like, I love life sims for the most part, especially games like this. So I'm super stoked on it. I will say that I am really hoping that they do a port to the Vita or the Thirdis.
It would be really cool to see it come to more platforms for sure. PC, it really lends itself to PC just because of having to click around the farm. Trying to do that anywhere else would be tough. 3DS would work.
They could just map that to a D-pad though.
If they can do Wii U and 3DS, that'd be great. And then yeah, PC.
Vita has a touchscreen also, so I mean.
And then Vita works too, as long as anything that has a touchscreen. I don't think this could work with, you know, using the right analog to control a cursor or something. I mean, you could make it work that way, but I just don't think it would be fun.
I mean, couldn't you just put character movement on, like, a D-pad and then... I don't fucking know what you would do for the cursor.
That's the thing. Movement you can do just fine.
Yeah. I guess you just make it so you actually
harvesting
have to, like...
my radishes now.
I guess, like, you could do, like, oh, you're within range of this, press A, like, make it context sensitive.
It could probably make it work. I don't know. It's one guy that developed this whole thing, so, you know, I don't know how much to really expect.
What is with, like, all these insanely talented people, like... making a game by themselves, like Axiom Verge and Undertale, and now this.
It's crazy. And what's so crazy is that they are responsible for some of my favorite games in recent years.
Did you like Axiom Verge?
All the other games have been really disappointing me. I have not gotten to play Axiom Verge, but just like looking at it. I love just looking at it. It looks like a beautiful, wonderful game that I want to play real bad. Haven't had the chance yet because, again, all these games have been coming out recently. Devil Daggers, Stardew Valley. I've been loving it. what was it, Super Hot? Super Hot just came out recently.
See,
it's
like,
been good.
Some of these games I really care about, and others I'm just like, eh, whatever.
Well, sure. I mean, yeah. And I had my ups and downs with games like The Witness and Super Hot. But,
the Witness,
you know,
like,
you get some hits, you get some misses, but they're still pretty good.
After finally getting to try The Witness, I'm like, oh man, I'm so glad I didn't buy this.
Yeah.
Like,
it's been, you know, I can admit it's a good game, but it's just too smart.
I just find it boring.
Can't, you know, like, and I've gotten to a point where I cannot move on, and I feel like I've wasted a little bit of money because I just can't. But I understand if it's boring. It gets boring if you, I don't, you know.
Yeah, hello? But like Super Hot, I was into. Are you there? Can you hear me? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, I'm getting your voice a little late. Hey.
Hey, how you doing?
That's really odd.
Oh, is it fixed now?
Hello?
All right. Hello, everyone. We apologize for that technical difficulties there. God damn it.
I don't know what happened. I'm going to stay out of Stardew Valley. That's what started it.
All right, well, so apparently Stardew Valley causes connection issues.
I don't know. I can't be sure.
You can
anyway.
Yeah, but I agree with you on the indie thing, because I've been playing Super Broforce, and it's been incredible.
Yeah?
It's... That game is dumb in all the correct ways. They have, like, just every possible... Like, they got... So instead of Braveheart, there's Broheart. And just like the game was just super grotesquely violent, and the game just like it's just fun. Like it's just fun to just go around and just murder people as these 80s, 90s, early 2000s action stars with like all this super hypo macho bro jokes.
That's cool.
I mean, for the love of God, the logo for the game is a. Like a bald eagle with giant metal biceps flexing with the American flag behind it.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Not gonna lie.
Yeah, it's a 2D shooter with some puzzle aspects. It's like it's not anything radically different, but man, I had fun with it.
All right. Yeah.
So, but yeah, Stardew Valley's rad. Would you recommend
Stardew Valley is rad. No, it's weird because I actually do not like Animal Crossing very much, but yeah, I don't know. There's something about this, just farming and getting to know people, romancing people. I got rejected by all the people I wanted to romance at the dance this spring.
So it's just
what
like
I'm saying
real
is
life.
A simulator. Like, yeah, yep.
High school was a fun time.
But
all right, well,
anyway, so yeah, it's fun, it's good, it's a good time. Sebastian's going to be mine, I swear. I just have to give him enough, what is he like, pumpkin soup? I have to look that up anyway.
I'm curious to see who the females are, because in I play my favorite Animal Crossing, or not my Animal Crossing, Harvest Moon was one on the GameCube, and I always romanced either the farmer chick or the artist chick.
So... gamer goth chick.
But that
is an option.
Good to know.
Yeah.
Don't
give her soda. She doesn't like soda. I learned that the hard way.
You tried to give her soda, and she was like, "I fucking hate this,
dude.
I hate
no.
you."
They are so dismissive. If you give these people the wrong thing, there was this Fabio guy I was giving like flowers to, and he's like, "Oh, a present. Thank you." He seemed really accepting of my gifts. and I forget what it was. It was like a different kind of flower, just one specific species of flower. And he just has this like dismissive face and he says, "I don't quite like this. I believe I should discard it." And then like throws it away. It's like, oh my God, that's hurtful.
Just why and, must you why must you hurt then, me, yeah. Fabio? Why?
He yeah, this Fabio looking motherfucker won't take my flowers. What a bitch!
you cut out during part of that, so it's just like this Fabio looking motherfucker.
No, so yeah,
won't take my flowers.
You do
pause, bitch. Lord.
Oh Jesus. No, it's good. There's a lot of mining involved. You farm, and then once you start getting enough money, you start heading into the mine. There's apparently like dozens and dozens of levels in the mine to kill slimes and harvest metals and get copper ore and whatever ore you need, and then you can socialize with people. It's a whole thing. It's fun. You can side with Joja Corporation if you want to and take over that community center and make it a warehouse. I don't know.
Like any good
American. I
ain't
gonna side with no corporation.
all right, well, that's cool. The game definitely seems super interesting. I'm super excited for it. Actually,
it's cool. $15.
I think that's probably the game we're gonna do for the early May 60-minute accesses.
There you go. Okay.
I'm going to blow everyone's minds and tell them the 6-minute access lineup, if everything goes right, all the way until E3.
Damn. So, all right.
This week, as you know, because the first part of it already posted, Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare 2.
Yes.
Pokken Tournament.
Yes.
Quantum Break.
Uh-huh.
Ratchet & Clank.
Mmm.
Dark Souls 3.
Jeez.
Question mark, which will probably be Stardew Valley.
Okay.
Star Fox Zero.
Yeah.
Uncharted 4. Battleborn. Overwatch.
Nice.
Mirror's Edge.
Yeah.
Doom.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, for those of you wondering when we'll be doing a video on Stardew Valley, probably around that time.
That'll be good.
Alright, well, is that it? Stardew Valley, Super Hot, anything else?
Oh, I played a little more Super Hot. I wish there was more to that game, given what they're charging. But, you know, it's fun while it lasts. And then played about an hour's worth, just a tutorial for Pokken Tournament. So I'm going to be digging into that game more tomorrow.
Since you haven't played much of it, can you give us a little bit of details on that? I know my copy should be shipping tomorrow.
Here's the only detail you need. Pikachu does a Stone Cold Stunner to a T. Stone Cold will be proud. Oh, it's so good. 10 out of 10. Done. There's your review.
All right.
Sorry. It's a down A. It's not even like a combo or something. You don't have to like turn. It's just down A, instant, well, practically instant Stone Cold Stunner from a Pikachu in a Pokemon game. It's fantastic. It's a lot of fun. The real hard, what I'm having difficulty with is their phase shifts, because it'll go into that 3D roaming phase, and then it can switch to your 2D fighter phase, or dual phase as they call it. And it'll switch back and forth depending on, like, there are certain moves that'll turn it to dual phase, and then it's only when you do enough damage does it shift back to run around phase, which I'm forgetting the name of. So it's interesting. And then there are different moves that only work in certain phases. So Stone Cold Stunner, you can only do in dual phase. Once you're in run around Tenkaichi mode, you can't use that move. You have to use a different part of your move set. And so it's interesting. It's actually kind of weirdly deep in some way. Not deep in any sort of like Street Fighter way, but I mean, it's part of Evo, I believe.
I believe it is an Evo this year. Well, I mean, it seems interesting. I you know,
I like it so far. I'm excited. I'm
a, like, as a fighting game guy, I'm going to look into it. I'll probably enjoy it. I'm not particularly big on Tekken, though, so that's my big concern.
It's not like Tekken.
Okay, great. You just sold me towards that game. Good job,
sir. There you go. Yeah, no, I have no idea why they named it Pokken Tournament. I don't know.
Probably because it was made by the...
Oh, it was made by Namco, but no, it's totally not Tekken at all. Apparently, in one comment of one of the videos I was looking at, someone compared it to the like a Naruto fighting game, but I've never played any of those.
I mean, that's not
I'm not
bad.
Sure about that.
But that's not a bad thing, then. I mean,
it's just different.
Yeah, all right.
And I like it.
All right, that's cool.
Then I played like half hour of Ark, which is like that weird like survival dinosaur.
Yeah,
game.
My friend Ivy's super into that game.
Okay.
So...
I spawned in the deep darkness and started wandering towards a red light and died three times from various dinosaurs and said, okay, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. I need to stop. So I haven't played very much of that, but I'm going to try and get into more. But that's it for me.
Yeah. Okay. Check back with me on that one next week, because I hear some crazy stories coming out of that game, very similar to DayZ in The Division.
Yeah.
So, is there anything else?
Not in terms of games playing. That's pretty much summing it up.
Cool. I'm super excited to get into Pokken Tournament, so hopefully we'll talk about that next week.
Yeah.
I'm actually considering, like, bringing my Wii U to work to play on my, like, downtime because of it.
Damn. That'd
yeah,
be great.
I know. Yeah, that game, that gamepad gameplay finally gets some use.
Exactly. You know?
So
all right,
that's so, everything we've been playing. So we got news. I come
news.
With news.
Not,
Mary,
they're not called olds.
Diablo is coming.
Is that so?
No, that's not actual news at all.
Oh, okay.
I wish
we'll just
it
hide
was.
In the grass until it gets here.
I'd be pretty excited for a new Diablo.
Well, that's not going to happen for a while.
God damn it.
I'm afraid to say.
So,
what's up?
Final Fantasy 15, which has been in development for a decade, finally has a
like
rumored
it.
Release date.
Okay.
Final Fantasy 15 is supposedly coming out on PlayStation 4 and Xbox One on September 30th.
Okay. Yeah.
Of course, this isn't official until Square Enix makes its official announcement at its Uncovered event in Los Angeles.
Damn.
But it makes sense considering this is a couple of days into the fall season.
Right. No, yeah, that's great. Perfect timing. I'm excited for that game.
Final Fantasy Road Trip.
Right in that area where it's just a little after Madden, but before the real storm.
It's right before my birthday and right after yours, which is where a lot of good shit starts coming out. So
that's usually yeah. So it's good, great. I'm excited.
Wow, your microphone just like your connection must have just got way better because you got a lot more clear.
Oh, weird. I don't know what's going on. Yeah.
Someone stopped torrenting massive amounts of pornography at your house.
Click.
How great would that be? Just like, yeah, I'm turning it off. Oh, you're better. This is like way better.
Oh, weird. I don't know.
So.
No, I wonder if it's still downloading Heroes of the Storm back here or not. I don't know.
It,
whatever.
It might be, so... yeah.
Anyway.
I'm as our friend McKenna calls it, Final Fantasy Bishi Road Trip. Yep. So,
exactly what I want.
It looks good. That demo they released last year was pretty good, so I'm down for more of it.
Sure.
So, hey, you remember how awesome Shadow Complex was?
Yeah, I do.
What would you do if I told you, hey, it's on PS4 and Xbox One? Well, it just came out on Xbox One, and it's coming to PS4 in May and Steam in May, and it's on Epic Games' own weird thing right now.
Fantastic. Yes. So if you anything to keep that game alive in the minds of the modern gamer.
If you want to play a prettier version of that game, I think it was free for a while on Epic Things. I remember dating
it was.
Free. Yeah, I got that.
That was a while ago.
I made sure to download it when it was free.
Right. Ugh, so good.
So, yeah, that was one of our... I believe that game got second place on our game best Xbox game that year.
It may have. I believe it.
You know what? Why not? Let's find out. I'm sure... Cannot believe we still keep this page running in some fashion.
It's so weird.
Let's see. Features, 2009 earlier. Game of the Year Awards, 2009. Let's see, 360. Jesus, this is so old. My God. It got second place behind Liberty City Stories.
Wow.
What? You're lagging so bad, dude.
Now this is bad.
Someone is torrenting pornography at your house again. So, everyone, sorry for more technical difficulties.
God, it never ends. Ray's not even here.
Yeah, I know. Well, I'm fixing his internet problem this upcoming week because I'm giving him my 50-foot Ethernet cable and he just bought a new router.
There you go.
I am making sure that he is on a hardline connection with a brand new router.
Good.
So.
I just need to work on mine.
I am not on a wired connection. My computer is about 3 inches from my router, so I'm good.
Yeah, that's all right.
So yeah. Anyway, what were we on? The Shadow Complex, right?
Yeah, Shadow Complex.
So yeah, Shadow Complex coming out on. It's already out on Xbox One. It's already out on PC, but it'll be on Steam and PS4 in May. Woo! So, speaking of games getting ported to other platforms, Axiom Verge is moving to Wii U and Xbox One.
Woo!
The Vita version just is going through certification right now, and he's in the process of porting it over to Wii U and Xbox One. So if you haven't played one of the most underrated games of last year, go for it.
Yeah, it's great.
Especially if you're like waiting on a Metroid game that Nintendo's never going to make. So.
Oh, man.
Moving forward, Sony is no longer publishing Rime. Rime was this kind of like ICO style game that Sony has been plugging in as an exclusive since Gamescom 2013. When Microsoft passed on Rime, it went to Sony. And then now Sony is no longer publishing it. Developer Tequilaworks says it's been chosen to reacquire the rights to the open world adventure game Rime and is working hard to realize its aspirations for it. Tequilaworks' previous game, Deadlight, was published by Microsoft and was an exclusive to 360 and PC. So...
Okay. Well, that's a bummer.
Yeah, hope it gets published, dude. More power to you.
Yeah.
The fine folks at Microsoft are partnering with some people to make sick as hell Killer Instinct figures.
Okay.
They are making Jago, Saberwolf, Fulgore, and that new chick from Hasako from season 2. And there is going to be a Spinal Shipwreck Cove Deluxe set, and a 9-inch Jago electronic sound link figure is going to come at a later date. Each figure costs $30. They're coming out later this year.
Cool.
I love how much backing Microsoft is putting behind Killer Instinct. Can we just discuss that?
I mean, you know, it's been one of their main draws from what I've seen anyway.
I mean, like, because it's been just years since the last one. And then, like, this game kind of had no right to be as good as it was, right? Like, sure. It was being developed by the guys who made, like, a Silent Hill for the PSP. And then it was, like, a free-to-play launch title with, like, 8 characters. Or it launched with 6 and ended up with 8. And then it just, like, blew up into one of the best fighting games out there. And now it's season 2 and onward is being made by the Dive Kick guys.
It's so strange.
Like, what the fuck?
Yeah. It's cool, though. I'm glad that it's getting, you know, attention.
Yeah, as a KI fan, after waiting for almost 2 decades, this has been great for me.
Right.
So, adorable Shovel Knight plushies are available for pre-order. that's really all I gotta say.
It's interesting.
At We Love's Finds collection of Shovel Knight plush toys is expanding to 2 new stuffed knights, Shield Knight and Plague Knight. You can pre-order them now. And you can already buy Shovel Knight. So, there Good. You go.
Nice.
They're $28 each, and they are 13 inches long. And Shovel Knight comes with a shovel, and Troop King plays music. So,
okay.
They're expected to ship in July.
Nice. Shovel Knight's great.
Shovel Knight's rad. I have his amiibo, actually, even though I bought that game on PlayStation.
Hey, man. That would be a cool little figure to have.
Indeed. So, more Nintendo news. The Zelda Wii U director hints at Western influences. According to the director, Eiji Onuma, they're looking to offer something new with the upcoming Wii U title. The change in flavor will be like going from Japanese food to Western-style food, and players will likely be surprised. He acknowledged that previous entries in the series have heavily relied upon the structure of Ocarina of Time, calling it the base of their secret sauce. However, this time their team aims to make something new, like Ocarina of Time was when it launched on N64. With regards to the status of the game's development, he says things are progressing well. The game has really taken shape and things have gotten easier. He noted that when the team was at the end stages of development on Skyward Sword, he was in charge of the in-game text and character dialogue, and that's currently what he's working on for the Wii U title.
Huh. Okay. Well.
Yeah. Cool.
Sure.
You know, hopefully they can, like, because Zelda just, like, Twilight Princess was kind of like the last time they could have got away with, you know, doing Ocarina, like, again with some changes. Like, but Skyward Sword, like, proved that 100%.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
You know, and then, like, I played A Link Between Worlds, and that was awesome just because of there were so many changes to it from other Zeldas.
Really good.
So I'm glad to see that they're continuing that.
Yeah, I'm still crazy excited for their next Zelda games.
Yep. So we got some news about Gears 4. It's gonna
really?
It's going to take place 20 to 30 years after the end of 3. And they say it'll star Marcus Fenix's estranged son. And Gears 4 story will be, quote, darker and more in line with the tone of the first games. They said the game will be very, but the game will not be a survival horror game. It will still be very much an action game.
Gears of War 2 was not dark.
I think he's more referring to like Gears 1.
I know, but like we watched like Dom's wife's corpse fall out of that thing.
Yeah.
Like
I remember we were playing that co-op and we were making fun of that too. We were really awful people.
Well, I mean, you know, it's so crazy extreme, like so quick.
So cheesy too, the way they do it.
Fuck, man. No. Making games more like Gears 1. I don't think this is a very popular opinion, but I hold it. I like Gears 1.
I would have preferred to make it like Gears 2. Yeah. Bigger, badder, more badass with giant worms that you go inside of.
That was when they introduced Horde mode, wasn't it?
Yes.
That Horde mode's great.
Horde in Gears 3 is still the best Horde mode in any video game.
Right.
So good.
Use more.
So, Ferguson, the director, says, is aiming to tell a more intimate and personal and morally ambiguous narratives in the past few games. He said the first Gears of War was a suspenseful game about dangerous creatures in a universe. Gears 3 was focused on the humans and locusts and lost that tension. The developer of the Coalition is attempting to bring Gears 4 back to its roots by evoking, in his words, that sense of mystery of things that go bump in the night. He says Gears 4 story, which follows Marcus Fenix's son, JD, and two other new characters, and it takes place over the span of 24 hours. There is going to be couch co-op, limited to 2 players, locally and online, and not 4, as the case with Gears 3. The resolution and frame rate has also been confirmed, and they said that there is possibly a PC version in the works.
Nice.
The game is supposed to launch on the Xbox One, at least, in fall 2016. And the beta will be held in April. The game will also be playable at PAX East.
Wow.
So, I'm guessing it's just multiplayer, though. Which...
Oh, yeah, no, totally all multiplayer. With, like, some art from the single player.
Oddly enough, this is actually the first time I've ever seen PAX East actually sold out before the show.
Oh, really?
But yeah, PAX East is officially sold out, so they managed to find a way to make that giant-ass convention center sold out. Because you gotta remember, that convention center is, like, way bigger than the Zelda one. Or not the Seattle one. Why did I say Zelda one? Jesus Christ.
I don't know, that was weird.
The Seattle one. Way bigger than the Seattle one. I think it's because we were talking about Zelda before this. It's significantly larger than the Seattle Convention Center that they use for PAX Prime, which is why like Prime always sells out, but East doesn't. But even this year, East is sold out. And it's
crazy.
And it's at a way later date too. It's like April 22nd, which that's also hella weird.
Right.
I love PAX, but man, it's like that is hella weird. Is that stuff?
Yep.
I'm kind of curious who they're gonna have at the music for East this year. Like, we're probably not going, but I'm always curious. Curious at the bands that they pick for that thing.
Do they tend to pick mostly the same people?
So, like, sometimes they do and sometimes they don't. Like, they'll have, like, a 3-4 year stretch where it's the same bands, and then the next year, like, oh, are we going to get these guys again? Nope. I remember, like, the first time I went, I was super stoked about, like, the Proto Man. They weren't there, but then the next year I went, they were. So, I mean...
Huh, whatever.
All
right, well, we'll see what happens.
Yeah, I, you know, years ago I had an opportunity to go to PAX East, and I did not take it. And that was dumb. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, well. I've been to Prime twice, though, which that was. So, that was awesome. So, I guess it balances out.
PAX is great. Well, I have opinions on PAX. No, it's a longer conversation.
Go ahead. Hey, that's the podcast for.
You know, to be honest, like a lot of it was like you walk into this giant thing and there's a. I love the spectacle of it. That's fantastic. But good God, I don't want to step in any of those lines.
And that's why you do what I do, where you don't get involved with the expo hall except for like three or four games, if that.
It was very much we're hanging around the indie corner because we want to check out the indie games, because honestly those tend to be the most interesting as well as have small to no lines.
Right, like it's the same thing with E3, like E3 getting coverage of Halo 5 like is a nightmare. Like I remember it was like I went up to ask them, I was like, yeah, how long was the line for? They're like, 4 hours. And I'm like, you know what? I'm good. I think I'm going to go write a preview of Gravity Ghost because I can actually go see that game.
Right. So, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's fine. It seems like an opportunity to... You really have to be going for either the panels. You can't really be going to be shopping because you can get everything on the internet.
That's not entirely true. There's...
I mean, unless, if you're getting some like local artist or something, maybe not. But
also like they have a lot of import shit. That's like that lightning figure I found would have been significantly more expensive on the internet.
It would have been either more expensive or more difficult. I'll give you that. But in the grand scheme of things, the majority of it is like, oh, there's a big ThinkGeek booth. Okay.
Yeah,
I know
like
where to get this.
Yeah, like that's why you go to like the Pink Elephant and like the weird import places.
Oh yeah, that's... but actually, the Pink Elephant has physical places in here. If I wanted to, I could probably.
Yeah, that's true.
Go
but
check
like,
them out.
In my case,
most people's cases, that people that are coming in, you know, like, from everywhere.
Like for me, Pink Elephant is a once a year thing.
Sure.
Versus, you know, so. So them having it at the convention, super convenient.
But you know, there's your panels and stuff. But like, you have to really care about a select few games to justify spending that kind of money to spend more than half the day in a line.
Yeah, like that was crazy to me. Like I remember Hayden wanted to see Skyrim so badly when we were there in 2012 or 2011. And I'm just like, yeah, you can go sit in line for 4 hours. I'm going to go to this panel and go to this other panel and have lunch and go play this World of Warcraft trading card game because they're doing a free demo.
Right.
So, like, and that's kind of what I do when I go there. Like, I go to panels and I go to meet people and hang out with people that I see, like, once every 2 years if I'm lucky. And stuff like that, like concerts, you know,
yeah,
that kind of stuff. Like last time I was to a PAX, it was 2012, and these were the games that I played on the expo hall floor: Dance Central 3, Halo, PlayStation All Stars, which had no line whatsoever.
Nice.
Borderlands. And Madden. Okay, so that's five games. Two of those had no line. One of those had a very small line. Mm-hmm. And then Halo. Quinn and I are huge Halo fans, so we were willing to wait for it.
Right.
And we were smart. We went there like right as it opened on Sunday, so we could, you know, beat the crowds.
Yeah.
And then Borderlands. I had no intention to play that because the lines were crazy. But then, like, I walked by the booth when Gearbox's panel was going on, and, like, there were barely any people in line. I decided, well, because their panel was going on.
I mean, yeah, but still, you'd think Borderlands, you'd still be drawing a crowd even for people that aren't going to that panel.
Well, it's because at their panel they give away free shit. Yeah, like in 2011 they gave away Borderlands 2, and then the year after they gave away the season pass for the game. So
jeez. Yeah.
So yeah, like I, so And then, like, I tried a bunch of indie stuff that didn't have lines. Or, like, had very small lines, like, maybe 2-3 people. And then the rest of the time I went to panels, I went and I checked out, you know, I went and met with people, you know, I went to the free playroom and entered a couple of, like, tournaments that I had no intention of winning. I just wanted to compete in for fun. I went to a Yu-Gi-Oh! Tournament, because they said, yeah, it's traditional format, which is no ban list, so you can bring old decks. I paid $5 and entered it for fun.
Nice. How'd you do?
I did okay. You know, like, I was kind of bewildered in a lot of the new stuff, but, you know, I did all right. So
cool. Good.
Yeah, like, it's one of those things where, like, I think anyone who goes for the expo hall is really misguided or just really wants to see some of that stuff.
It has to be, yeah, just going to want to see a lot of that stuff because... Yeah.
Because my logic is, like, this shit's out in, like, 3 months, 2 months anyway.
Well, right, yeah, that's the thing, is a lot of these are getting so close to being out that it's just not, yeah, it's not worth it at all. You have to really want to play one specific game. You can justify going and sitting in line for 3 or 4 hours for one specific game, or like last year's PAX, you know, you're sitting in line to check out Oculus or one of the VR experiences in the optimal environment.
Yeah, because you can't do that elsewhere. Like, you're not going to, you know.
Right, that was a big thing.
Yeah. But,
and that made sense completely.
But, like, I remember the lines, like, I laughed my ass off at those Borderlands lines in 2012, because I'm like, the game's out in 3 weeks. You can go buy it. You can go buy it in 3 weeks. You know, like, I don't understand you people. You know, in 2011, I did wait in one really long line, and it was for Uncharted 3.
Okay, sure.
But you know what? I did get some benefit out of that because while you were waiting in line to see the single player demo, they let you play the multiplayer.
Oh, that's amazing.
Oh, and it gets even better. When you watched the single player demo, they gave you a t-shirt at the end.
Dude, what? Oh, yeah. That's great.
I still have the shirt. I can't fit into it because it's a large. Even when I was in really good shape, a large was a somewhat tight shirt. And when I got that shirt, I was growing at a very rapid rate versus what I'm doing now, where, like, I've hit my 240s and I've kind of plateaued for the time being.
I see.
But that's still significantly lighter than what I was.
Yeah, that's great.
But yeah, so I don't know. Like, I think, like, I love the environment, like you said. I love the spectacle. You know, the panels I generally find entertaining. Like, I'm gonna be honest, it's worth paying the ticket price kind of just to see the giant bomb panel in concerts for me.
Yeah. Sure.
And then, like, that. If they keep doing it, going to Mario Party Party in person.
Jesus. Nuts.
It's just like, yeah, that's the joke, you guys sitting up front, you're trapped here for the whole 5 hours.
No, it's totally, yeah, it's a fun time if you know where to go, but, like, the big spectacle bits in the expo hall are not really why you're there.
Not if you're smart about it, no, not at all.
Unless there's something amazing that's not going to be out for months and months.
Yeah, like, it, you know, and usually that's not the case, and it's not ready for the public to see it, because that shit isn't even available at E3 a lot of the times, is what I found, going to E3.
Sure. Yeah.
So, yeah.
But, man, how did we get to PAX? What were we talking about?
Because something was going to be available. Oh, Gears was going to be available at PAX. That's it.
Oh, right. Yeah.
So, really? Because if you're PAX East, go try it. Tell us how it is. We'd love to know. So... Going forward, as I read through all the massive amounts of news we have this week.
Yeah.
Blizzard Overwatch expanded universe details. So, with Overwatch release date approaching, Blizzard has shared the details of its expanded universe starting in March. It's going to have animated shorts followed by digital comic shorts and a graphic novel. It's planned for the series of animated shorts at last year's BlizzCon. They'll be periodically leading up to the release of the game. And they will explore Overwatch's most iconic heroes, revealing the future those heroes are fighting for. They'll also release digital comics for free as the game ramps up. McCree, the game's vigilante gunslinger, is the star of the first comic short, and it's going to debut in April. First graphic novel takes place decades before the events of the game and the global robot uprising called the Omnic Crisis.
Huh.
I'm down for this.
Hey, you know.
Overwatch has cool characters. Blizzard typically has really good lore. I'm excited to see where they go with this.
I love the design and the energy of that game. I'm getting good vibes. I just hope they follow through on it completely.
I mean, like, I played the beta, and from a gameplay standpoint, it's super fun.
Great. Good. There are some characters in that list that I like.
Yeah.
A lot. Just purely on their design.
Oh, that's how I am with Tracer. Like, I love the design of Tracer and Reaper. Like, just those two alone are just like, oh, I want to play this.
I see. Now I have to pull up the roster of heroes here.
The roster of heroes. Look at this.
Because, yeah, Tracer is a fantastic look. God, they're just so... Oh, my God. Whoever did the art for a lot of these... Like Junkrat and Zarya and McCree.
I will say the worst thing in the world is I pre-ordered the game during my last check. Okay.
Okay.
And it's already annoying having like the beta in the launcher but not being able to access it because it's a closed beta.
Right.
But then making it 1,000 times worse is like clicking on it now, seeing the button that says install grayed out, and says, you've purchased Overwatch. Overwatch is expected to release on 5/24/2016. It's just like, you want to play it, and some people are playing it, but we're not going to let you play it until the 3rd.
Oh, it's getting there. It's almost finished.
If it weren't for the fact that I need the money, I'd probably take off the 3rd through the 9th just to play that game's beta. God, when does that beta starts on a Tuesday and goes until a Monday?
Yeah.
I'm gonna be playing that on my grave shift. I'll bring the laptop and just that grave shift is gonna go by fast.
It'll be a fun game.
So, moving forward. Sony is cagey on Xbox One, PS4, cross-network play. Xbox opened the door to cross-network play on Monday. Sony has commented on the question whether PlayStation Network and Xbox Live users could play together across console barriers in the future, but avoided a definite yes or no answer and even refused to name Xbox. Responding to the direct question about working with Microsoft from GameSpot, Sony said PlayStation has been supporting cross-platform play with PC on several titles as far as back as 2002 with Final Fantasy XI on PS2 and PC. We'd be happy to have a conversation with any publisher or developer who are interested in cross-network play.
Okay. It'd be cool if they go through with all that.
Speaking on Monday, Microsoft's Chris Charla made it clear that the opportunity for Xbox PS4 online play is there, but it's up to developers and console manufacturers to make it a reality, extending an open invitation to Sony to make the first fully cross-network Xbox One game, Rocket League, playable between the two.
Yeah. Yeah.
So...
I'm down. Yeah,
I'm absolutely down for that. Alright, finally, the last couple pieces of news are about PlayStation VR.
Yes. Heard about this.
PlayStation VR is coming out in October, and it is the cheapest VR at $399. The bad part is you will need a PlayStation camera, which it bumps this price up by $40.
So it's actually $440.
Yeah. I already own one, though, because I'm a live streamer, so...
Well, yeah, no, same here, but, like, for a lot of people, I can't imagine that they got the eye.
Yeah. But, yeah, reading about it, it's going to be launched at $400 in October. It includes, like, all the cabling you need, the headset, like, all that stuff. 230 developers are working on games for it, including an exclusive by the Japan studio. This is the current list of PlayStation VR games that are confirmed. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. I'm just going to name notable titles.
Okay.
Because currently it's actually a pretty healthy list. 100-foot Robot Golf. Ace Combat 7. Cyber Danganronpa VR. Look, Danganronpa is an amazing franchise. Don't scoff.
It's just an interesting. It's just interesting.
Don't give me your.
It's just interesting. That's all.
Drive Club.
Oh, Desert, weird. Okay.
Desert Bus 2.0.
Yes.
Dead or Alive Extreme 3. Because we need VR for them anime boobies.
Sure. Why not?
Moving forward. Eve Valkyrie. Final Fantasy XIV: A Realm Reborn. Gran Turismo Sport.
Okay.
Hatsune Miku Project Diva. Yes.
All right.
Please. Yes. sign me up for that. It was already pretty great when you had that stupid phone app and she would dance on your Domino's order. This is even better. let's see. Jurassic Encounter. Let's see. Like I said, Gran Turismo Sport, because Gran Turismo supports all dumb technology add-ons. Project Cars. So you have plenty of racing game options. Res Infinite. Star Wars Battlefront. Fuck yes.
Jeez, okay.
That's put me in the Star Wars. Put me
in. They should just have that as the tagline when they sell it. Put me in the Star Wars.
I'd buy that.
You know what? This actually gives me hope. This list of games. These are some games that I want to play, and that's something that a lot of VR headsets are not offering right now. So
Sony's really good about courting developers. They know what they're doing. Surgeon.
And that's the perfect time.
Surgeon Simulator, and they're the cheapest headset.
Right.
Surgeon Simulator. Tea Party Simulator.
Oh, man.
Tekken 7.
Okay.
Rock Band VR.
Right.
Until Dawn, Rush of Blood, and that the rest of these are just... Oh, and Volume Jesus. Code. Volume was a really good Vita game that came out fairly recently.
Okay. So, that sounds great.
That is not a terrible list. Like, outside of Gran Turismo and like outside of Gran Turismo, it's nothing I'm like super interested in. But, you know,
some of those games are not games I would normally be interested in, but like a lot of them are like, "Oh man, I wonder what that would be like in VR."
Yeah, like Gran Turismo in VR is just the most enticing though. Like that with my 7.1 Astros, like, dude, just that.
Sure, yeah.
Just like that and Star Wars, like Star Wars with 7.1 headphones and VR, like I will fucking take that headset off and I will think I am Luke Skywalker.
Right.
So, but there is some more good news about PlayStation VR.
Okay.
Other than its cheap price tag in comparison to its competitors, and it actually having games unlike its competitors, it is going to have a cinematic mode.
Oh, good. So, is that what I think it is?
So what this means is you will be able to play the vast majority of your PS4 games on PlayStation VR using it like a screen.
Nice. Okay.
So what it would simulate is you in front of a, like, it. So the way it would work is it like would put you in a fake space and it would simulate a giant screen that's like 5 meters across.
I wonder. Yeah, I wonder if that's. I wonder. Yeah, I wonder. Is it? Have you seen? Is there a video of it?
No.
Oh, okay. But I was gonna say it'd be really fun to have like a Xbox 360 Netflix kind of room where you're sitting in an actual movie theater. When you look at the screen.
I think that's you know, what they're trying to do with it. But I'm gonna pull up the article real quick. All games can play in the cinematic mode that simulates a 5 meter screen within a virtual space. Let's see. Users can enjoy content on a virtual screen up to 225 inches, 5 meters, at a distance of 2.5 meters, which that's, let's see, 2.5 meters in feet. Let's see what that is. That is 8 feet. So, okay, do you remember my old bedroom, or my current bedroom, I should say?
Yes.
Like, 8 feet would be, like, the TV to, like, the middle of the bed.
Okay.
So a 225-inch screen at that length away.
I'd be down.
So, yeah, like, this could be an interesting substitute for televisions, I guess, in some ways.
Well, I mean, I would have to experience it myself. But yeah. Because when you hear it, it's like, why wouldn't I just have it plastered, like, just on the VR screen regularly? Why would I have to look in one direction?
Because you... Yeah, but, like, then there's also the fact that, like, maybe you don't want to have a headset strapped to your face for every type of media you watch.
Well, I mean, is that not what you're still wearing the headset when you're looking around in the cinematic mode?
Well, yeah, but I am saying that, like people who are like, oh, I'll just play all my games on this, like, man, as much as I want to play all my games and watch all my movies on what would feel like a 225-inch theater screen, I also imagine that I don't want to be wearing a headset all the time. It's just like how, as much as I love my Astros and they're amazing, I will sometimes choose to not have as good audio quality, literally for the purpose of I'm not in the mood to wear headphones.
Huh.
So,
okay.
Granted, yeah. it's not all the time, but it's, you know, something happens.
Sure.
That's super cool though. Like, I mean, yeah, I think that's actually, you know, that's actually a really cool idea in theory though.
In theory, yeah, we'll have to see how it actually actually works when we start using it.
Yeah, you gonna be buying one at launch? Are you thinking about it?
Oh, probably not. I'll probably wait on it for a little bit. It's cool. Maybe a Christmas present or something, but yeah.
I've been hosed by new tech too many times to get this at launch.
Right. So it's rough to be the early adopter, especially for something that's going to be, you know, at the beginning so expensive.
Yeah, like I've been an early adopter of a lot of stuff, and I typically have no issue with it, but this is one where I'm gonna hold off.
Yeah, it seems cool. I hope they have enough reason for me to support it, but it's on them to get the games in and deliver on a meaningful experience in VR.
Hopefully it all pans out. Like, hopefully, like, in a year, like, we're coming here, like, using our PlayStation VRs as our, like, primary screen for everything, and, like, use and like plugging our computer into it, being going, man, like, man, wasn't it fucking stupid when we said this wasn't going to be a success? Like that's the ideal world, right?
Right. Yep.
So anyway, last news story here is Uncharted 4 has gone gold.
Okay.
Uncharted 4, Naughty Dog's long development PlayStation 4 exclusive that at one point was scheduled to debut last year has gone gold. That means development on the base game is finished and discs are now headed for printing for the mass production for the game's May release date. The exclusive was first scheduled to launch last year in the fall, but was moved to March, then moved to April, but then finally had a two-week delay to May because of how many copies they needed to meet demand. Uncharted 4 is the final entry in the series that Naughty Dog plans to develop and the last one to feature Nathan Drake. However, the series may live on with another developer. Neil Druckmann, director of the game, shared this picture, what appears to be the first disc with the full game on it.
Nice.
Additionally, the game's other director, Bruce Straley, said in his own tweet that Uncharted 4 is possibly the most visually stunning game ever created and the best Uncharted ever created.
Jeez, that's saying a lot.
And they just released an Uncharted 4 mini documentary. About the making of the game.
That's cool.
So...
Soon we'll be playing another Uncharted game. I'm excited.
Yeah, I love this style of game, and I'm really geared up for this because I played through the collection and Tomb Raider all back to back last year, and was still like, I'm ready for 4. Give me a new one. So, right. Something about that so setting good. And that style of gameplay just super appeals to me.
When it's done right, man.
Yeah, like Tomb Raider and Rise of the Tomb Raider were both amazing. This game is, you know, like the first three Uncharted were all really good. Really good. So yeah. Anyway.
Oh, good. Yeah.
I'm ready for the Uncharted.
One more news story.
Oh, what is it? What did I miss?
I'm reading a news title saying Sony reportedly working on a PlayStation 4.5.
Oh, right. That thing.
Yeah.
I heard about this. Yeah. All right. So
basically selling a more powerful PlayStation for $400.
Because the 32X panned out so well.
Well, that's an add-on, right?
Yeah. But I mean, even then, though, this separates your market.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, it's going to cause some problems.
I love how in the article that you're talking about, like, at least the one I pulled up about this news, like, it shows every generation of the iPhone. And I love how I have had every other generation of the iPhone.
Oh, jeez.
I went from 3GS to 4S to 5S to 6S.
They're gonna have to come up with something similar to make transitioning to a more powerful PS4 is relatively smooth.
Because if both console manufacturers keep doing this, I'm just gonna say fuck this, and exclusively game on PC. Because then, like, you got, like, this literally gets rid of, like, the one thing consoles have. Which is, like, they stay static for, you know, years at a time.
Well, you know, they were static for, like, 8 years for the last generation. Was it 8?
Let's see. 360 came out in 05, November 05. So, yeah, 8 years. 7 for the PlayStation.
You had to buy that one console, and then you got a bunch of games.
Yeah, like, you bought a bunch of games, and, like, yeah, you had to upgrade hard drives, but that's about it.
Yeah, that was really it. It was just transferring storage. I mean,
yeah, like, it wasn't...
You wouldn't have to worry about performance, really.
Yeah, like, I knew people who made it through that generation with a launch 360.
Right. Like, there were a few of them, but they exist.
And then, like, I know tons of people who made it through with, like, launch PS3s, and, like, they won't give it up because it plays PS2 games.
Right.
So, yeah, like, nah, dude, like, fuck this. Fuck this, not, like, this literally gets rid of, like, the one thing consoles have. Which is, like, you don't need to upgrade, you don't need to worry about it, it's just, like, you can play all the games for it and whatnot. They said, developers confirmed to Kotaku that the new model would offer increased graphical power and can run games in 4K. This new model will retail for $400, which was the price of the current $350 model this past holiday season. There aren't many details about it. You know, it'd be a stopgap between now and PlayStation 5. Maybe they're going to try and get an incremental upgrade model like smartphones and tablets. The thing is, though, is people think of fucking game consoles differently than smartphones and tablets. Because the difference between a game console and a smartphone, and in some cases a tablet, is I need a smartphone. I need a phone.
Yeah. Sure.
I need a phone for work and for, you know, several other purposes. You know, pornography on the bus. You know, things like that. Things of that nature.
Sure.
I don't know what they're thinking. Because at this point, like, why wouldn't you just, like, go PC game? Like,
it's very strange. It seems like they're both trying to do PC things. They're seeing the success of PC and are trying to take lessons from it as they have adapt more and more. But it's getting weird now.
Yeah, like, it's like, what? No, this makes no sense. Like, I'm willing to, like, and I don't even upgrade my phone every year. I do every other year. That's because of the way the contract system works. Like, I remember I got my 3GS during my freshman year of college as a Christmas gift in 2010. Then in 2013, I upgraded to a 5S. In 2012, I upgraded to a 4S. In 2013, I upgraded to a 5S. And last year, I upgraded to a 6S. And when the 7S rolls around, I'll upgrade to that.
Great.
So, you know, like that... This shit they're doing with, like, this is a terrible idea for game consoles. I don't get the point of it. Like, first off, most console gamers don't care about incremental graphic upgrades that much. They want a big jump. They don't want little jumps. They could give a rat's ass about, you know, like, oh, this looks slightly better. Now, the 4K thing, I think in a couple of years it makes sense. I don't think 4K has enough market saturation for it to really matter to most people.
Not right now.
Because, like, I just bought a new TV, and I just, like, kind of, I could have chose a better 1080p picture or a 4K picture, and I'm like, well, I'm going to get the better 1080p picture. Sorry. You know, like, the cheapest 4K TVs that are of good size hang around $800, $700 to $800. So, yeah. So, I don't know, man.
We'll see what happens.
And every time that they try and do something like this, like the 32X or, you know, the N64 DDE, it's a fucking train wreck. So, no one want, like, and there's always someone who's like, we can do it right. No, you can't. Just stop. Just please. Just, like, make game, like, and the PlayStation 4 is selling fine. Like, it's on, like, PS2 level pace. Yeah.
It's very strange. I don't know. I like it just because I like the idea of people just doing weird, crazy shit. Which Xbox has been doing, and now, like, photos of, like, the possible NX controller, like, they're trying weird shit, and then Sony's trying weird stuff. Like, it's just crazy.
Like, you
just
fun
to watch.
We're 2.25 years into the PS4, and it's already at 40 million units.
Yeah.
Like it's almost there. It's at, like, 39. It's at 39 million. And I probably by the end of the month it will be at 40. And okay. And like why would you interrupt that? Just like It's Sega. It's like watching Sega happen again. Just no. Just put out good-ass games and do R&D for your next system and then put it out in 2020 or 2019. You know? Like, yeah, they came out in 2013, so yeah, put that shit out 2019, 2020, and worry about it then. But like, fucking, why would you... Oh, God.
It's very strange because, yeah, Sony's had the lead between Sony and Xbox specifically. And then Xbox has been making moves to try and really boost numbers. And I really like the way they've been handling it the last few months. Really all of Phil Spencer's time, really been enjoying what they've been doing. And for Sony to do something like this, I mean, I can't predict what's going to happen. It could help them maybe, but... It requires them to really handle this really carefully. And honestly, just at first glance, it just does not seem like a good idea. It doesn't seem worth it. People buy your console because you have the games. If you have the games, just keep having the games.
Yeah, like that's something that like Nintendo has understood for the most part, other than their terrible treatment of third-party developers.
Right.
But like... They just need to... Nintendo just needs third-party support, or everyone else needs to stop just, like, being dumb. Yeah, you know, these are all common... Like, it's all common-sense decisions, too. Yeah, Xbox has been making moves, but, like, they're... Xbox is going to be... It's that PS3 thing all over again, but even worse. Of, like, that the initial stupidity just kind of hurts them forever.
Yep.
But with them, it's even worse, though. Like, that's the beef. Quick side story. If you buy an Xbox One right now, you'll get Grand Theft Auto 5 for free.
Damn.
So, nice. Yeah, along with their billion other bundles.
Huh. Right.
Yeah. So, we got questions and comments.
We do?
Yes, we do. We got 4.
Yeah.
I'm gonna refresh the page, just double check. Yeah, okay, we got 4.
Okay.
Jay Chen for the win says corn can be a dessert. Ellipses. My mom used to make pudding with pieces of corn in it. Yes, sounds weird, but it was good. That's not corn as a dessert though. That is like that's an ingredient. What? What, Eric?
I don't know. Can you read that again? Read what that is again.
Corn can be a dessert. Ellipses.
No. Read that comment back. What corn in a what?
All right, I'm gonna read it. Corn can be a dessert. Ellipses. ... Yeah. My mom used to make a pudding with pieces of corn in it. Yeah, it sounds weird, but it was good.
I don't know. I don't know what qualifies as dessert anymore. Actually, going in depth on this whole conversation has made all lines blurred.
I'm gonna pull up the definition of dessert in a second, but I'm gonna.
Okay, yeah. Let's go ahead and get at least the technical terms. because I'm sitting here thinking like this is a really dumb thing to think, but for some reason I'm sitting here thinking like, oh, maybe if you made it cold, like that would be a dessert. But if it's warm, despite there being pudding in it and probably being the main ingredient, for some reason I can't see that as dessert.
Yeah, no, what, first off, what he described is dessert, but that's pudding that just happens to have corn in it.
Like that's not, the corn that's itself corn is not working. Dessert. But
yeah, corn is not
but the meal
dessert.
As a whole could be considered a dessert, I guess. It just seems weird. It's crossing too many lines.
Okay, cake, pie, fruit, pudding, ice cream, etc. served as the final course of a meal. British. A serving of fresh fruit after the main course of a meal.
Have we done a Google search of dessert corn?
I'll get to that in a minute. Glad Ray isn't here this week, dear fucking lord.
Oh, Jesus. There's some pictures on the internet here.
Dessert
corn.
The sweet, usually last course of a meal.
Uh-huh.
Let's see, moving forward. So yeah, first off, in what he's describing, that's not Like, that's not corn as a dessert.
Like, well, I mean, how is Ray using it? What were the meals he described?
So the primary one he described was like corn on the cob with cinnamon on it, which that's definitely not.
See, I feel like our listener here, their pudding with corn idea, I think, more qualifies for dessert than corn with some cinnamon on it.
Like that I could see as a dessert, but like even then, I don't consider that as like corn as the main bit of it though. It's like
have corn be the main thing. It has to be primarily pudding.
It's like when you have like strawberry cheesecake. It's like, yeah, okay, it has strawberries on it, but the dessert is the cheesecake. It just happens to have strawberries on it.
Right.
Oh. You know?
I mean, I could see corn being an ingredient in a dessert if used properly, but I feel like there are very few places, or I'm just not thinking of the right food.
I agree corn can be an ingredient in a dessert, but corn on the cob on its own is not a dessert.
It says, you now find desserts made with corn on many restaurant menus. Corn ice cream. Ugh. Corn cake, corn panna cotta, and more. This is from Huffington Post. I don't want to go through your slideshow. But yeah, no, there's apparently that there are, you know, act surprise, there are corners of the internet where there are articles on how to integrate corn into your desserts.
There's corn, man, there's internet articles about anything, but I am saying that, like, fucking corn on its own, or like as the primary like part of the meal, is not a dessert. It's
you'd have to prepare it in a very unorthodox way to make it work.
Like,
and I don't know if that's possible.
Like, and what he described is like corn, like in pudding, which that's just pudding that has corn in it. Like, that's not corn as a dessert.
You would call it corn pudding. Corn being the adjective.
Yeah, like there's
pudding being the actual thing.
There's corn in this pudding. Oh, not the other way around. Yeah,
like, I think it's weird, but looking at this, it seems like corn can certainly be integral into a dessert if you really want to.
Oh yeah, people fucking put corn in bread pudding all the time. You know, which do you know what bread pudding is?
I don't.
Oh, it's fucking awesome. Bread pudding is the shit.
Okay.
So what it is they use like leftover dough from like donuts and like stuff like that and cakes, and then they like put it all together and like make it into like this weird like cake that's just doughs from different other types of cake.
Nice.
And then they cover it in caramel and whipped cream. Yeah, it's the shit.
Damn.
It is like the Golden Silver has it in Reno. So good.
That sounds fantastic. Goddamn. Sounds like a good like 3 a.m. meal, little dessert thing.
Yeah, like it's super cheap there too, because it's just fucking leftovers from all the other stuff they make.
Right. Shit. I think corn pudding can qualify as a dessert. Then again, I feel it feels weird qualifying that as a dessert. I feel like it's definitely more dessert than not.
Yeah,
but it's
because,
like crossing this line is making me ask questions I never wanted to ask.
Because it's pudding with corn in it. It's not. You know, it's not fucking. It's not like. It's not like someone like blended a bunch of corn together and added like milk and fucking cocoa powder and said, oh man.
Who knows? Maybe that's good.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It might be good, but
just take a bunch of corn, throw it into a blender. And then, yeah, add milk and cocoa, see how it is. I don't know why. I don't know what that would add. I'm not a huge fan of corn, so I'm not going to try it myself.
I like corn on the cob with, like, butter. Like, this is like saying, like, French toast is a dessert. Like, it's more of a dessert than fucking corn is, but no, it's a breakfast. So
I don't know. Yeah. Everyone has their different rules and lines when it comes to breakfast. There are some general guidelines. corn seems to be one of these touchy ones where, like, yeah, you could find people on the internet to support, like, Desert Corn, 47.9 million results.
See, that's not an argument for me in this day and age there's someone on the internet who fucking, like, believes in everything stupid. Like,
give me two different foods, completely different.
Pasta and cake.
194 million results. Oh God, I want these.
Why? What is it?
Well, it's the pictures I'm looking at aren't actually cake. It looks like they cooked pasta and then molded it into the form of a cake. So it's like, it looks like a bowl of pasta got perfectly removed from the bowl and retained its shape.
Okay.
Fucking and sure. It looks it's kind of, it's like pasta lasagna.
Looks
really good. Actually.
I mean, actually,
but that's not cake.
Yeah, that's not cake. And like the closest thing to a cake that is pasta related is lasagna. Like that's a pasta.
Yeah, that's the closest thing to a pasta cake. And there's no real cakeness about it. You're not getting the dessert bit of it. But goddamn, am I getting hungry looking at this? I have to get away. Cake. Ask her by name. I don't know. Yeah. Pudding corn. Corn pudding. It's not pudding corn. If you were to liquefy corn into a sort of pudding-like substance and then, like, chilled it, and that if that not, tasted good...
That would not be a dessert still.
No?
I would say that's just corn. That's cream.
Even if you have the same context...
That exists. That's cream of corn, bro.
Does cream corn taste like... Is that just like ice cream if you make that cold?
No, it tastes like corn. Because it's like it, and not like a sweet corn, like just corn. And that's not dessert. That's cream corn. What? Yeah. It has a name. Pudding corn is a thing. It's cream corn.
I know. So, but if you had the exact same consistency as pudding, and it's just like the corn flavor.
No, because that's corn. It's just fucking like a dessert. Like no.
I know that's where I'm willing to let the line. That's where I'm willing to let it slip a bit. Is if you have the consistency of pudding, like the only thing is just the flavor.
No, because I don't think that argument holds true for milk either, which is another topic we had to last week.
Oh, we've had that.
Which is
well, no, skim milk's not. I don't think skim milk counts because I think that's the same thing with consistency. It just tastes more, just from the way the texture, the way it feels, it's like water.
I'm saying, yeah, but I'm also saying that, like, the taste of fucking cream corn tastes nothing like pudding, even though it has a very similar consistency.
No, I'm sure it doesn't. I'm sure it doesn't.
That's just like these motherfuckers who are like, almond milk is milk. No, it's fucking not! No, it's not!
You know... Whatever they want to make, whatever they want to eat. I don't know when we became food Nazis, Bronson. Remember when we wanted to make the Pake?
We were
wild and free with our food once, too.
But then I smartened up. Smartened up, that's what happened.
We never did eat the Pake, we never made one.
Do you want to make one?
Dude, you come up here to Seattle. Let me know when you're willing to go... to Walmart, we'll pick up a cake. We'll get like one of those small Celeste pizzas to put on top because those are roughly the same size.
Yeah, it was basically like what was it?
That's what it was, right? It was like
it was like pizza with a cake and then another pizza on top and then a frosting on top of that.
JonTron made a joke about it, but it was cheesecake rather than just cake, and it was just like he took a slice and then put cheesecake on top of the pizza and then you bit into the whole thing.
That actually doesn't sound too awful. What did you think of it?
I don't know. I don't know. I haven't tried. It's driven me mad since sophomore year of high school. It sounds like the dumbest thing in the world, but then I'll like go home from school and it's like, I don't know, maybe that could work. I don't know.
Now I'm just super hungry.
Now does that make that pizza a dessert?
Because it has... what would you say is the base of it? Is it the pizza or is it the cake?
I would have to assume if we're getting like a Walmart cake, it would be primarily cake.
then I would say yes, it's a dessert that just happens to be weird as fuck. all right.
I don't know. Whatever.
So we got a question from Dodger Blue, or a comment says, sometimes the loot was weird in the Division. I would climb ladder after ladder only to find a chest with a trendy beanie in it. Lol. I have nothing really to say on that.
I've heard that the gear in the Division is not necessarily super cool because it has to be in a realistic setting. So it's beanie.
That's a lot of the Division.
Damn.
Chef Curry says, when did this become the Food Network? Lol, milk and corn?
We just had another podcast. That was like a good 10-minute talk.
Oh, God.
If there's one thing I've learned from listening and participating in podcasts is that food is a fantastic conversation starter.
It is.
You could talk about that for a long, long time, especially if we talk about pizza. We talk about restaurants we've been to.
I've kind of found my ideal pizza.
What would that be?
Like, I've gone through a lot of work to find it, but I like
a lot of wasted weekends. Delivery guy knows my name.
But no, I've had.
I didn't order from him one weekend, and he sent me a note asking if I was okay.
Yeah, pizza guy knows me pretty well. No, but what I was saying is like I've tried to break out and try many different types of pizza because you know I want to find my ideal pizza, and I kind of finally found it. It's kind of a crispy crust, like an Italian style crust, like traditional. Heavy sauce, extra sauce, extra cheese. Pepperoni, olives, bacon, and beef.
Nice.
And then put a little bit of Parmesan on the top.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's fucking good.
Okay.
If I want to get real fancy, I'll add hot sauce.
Jeez.
Yep.
Nice.
So.
No, for my when I'm just trying to get from a chain, like Pizza Hut has been recently really good for me.
Oh yeah, that's if I'm going to like Chuck's Boulevard or Pisano's, which are my two pizza places of preference in Reno. If I'm going to a chain, I'm just like, yo homie, pepperoni and olives, extra sauce.
Yeah, absolutely. Have you in your time in Seattle, have you hit Big Mario's yet?
No, I have not.
Fuck, man, it is the best pizza I've ever had. And that's as someone who eats, you know, I love eating pizza. I love pizza to death. But yeah, like, Big Mario's, like, charge a lot, but it's great.
Like, restaurants in Seattle, I've been to the Hurricane, I've been to Dick's, I've been to the Crab Pot, I've been to Samurai Noodle.
Nice.
Yeah. No,
it's good.
Yeah, so I'll have to check it out. I went to Dick's on the recommendation of Giant Bomb, so...
Right.
I was pretty impressed with that burger. It wasn't Juicy's, but it was fucking good still.
Good. Great God. We need to... Yeah, Food Network. We need to stop or I'm going to die of hunger.
Start a food podcast.
Yeah.
Start that when we're up in Seattle, and then just like after every episode, it's like, well, we're going to go down to a restaurant now. spend several hundred dollars on food.
We do that before. We go and eat, but then we have a lot left over that we put in boxes, and we come back and we eat that while we're talking about that restaurant. And then, of course, recap the latest Chopped, Cutthroat Kitchen, Restaurant Impossible. You know,
Drives, Diners, and whatever. Dives, Diners, and Drive-Ins.
Yeah, Drive-Ins and Dives. Guys, Grocery Games.
The Golden Silver was actually on that show.
I remember seeing a little thing in Golden Silver talking about how it'd been on that show, but I haven't found it yet.
Look, I've watched that episode. It's actually pretty good. It made me want to go.
I have a hard time watching Guy Fieri for too long.
Well, yeah. My favorite thing is the picture of him in his car ride. He's like, we're going around America. Look for the best you know, drives, and then it's like behind him is like Fury Road, Mad Max.
Right.
Like, it was like,
Jesus, where the hell are you? All right. You're not going to find any food there.
Oh, God. I don't know. I'm actually going to Golden Silver for breakfast tomorrow. Speaking of Reno.
Good call.
Yeah, because some people wanted to hang out, and I was like, well, I usually wake up hungry, so sure, why not?
Cool.
Yeah. Anyway. Moving forward, we got a comment from Show Me Your Kitties.
Mmm.
And I like his avatar icon. It's a bulldog, like all dopey and happy. Says, "I feel you, Bronson. I can't stop playing Street Fighter V either. Called in sick 2 days in a row to play it."
Yeah, you know, it's Street Fighter.
Fucking good game.
You can do that.
Yeah. I also got a comment on my latest soapbox. I might as well respond to here if they listen. Creatine Mag says, "I would not say the Wii U was a failure. It still made a profit. That's like saying the GameCube was a failure, which it simply is not true." No, they've been losing money on the Wii U. Lots of it. So, yeah, it's been a fucking train wreck for them.
At the very least, it's been underwhelming.
So
No one's been able to pick up on, you know, the use of the gamepad and the cameras and the motion controls. Third parties have basically just abandoned that thing. And it sucks because there's some really good games on it, and I like using it for Netflix, and there's some really cool things about it, but...
But for the most part, nah.
Well, you know, I'm loving it right now for Pokken Tournament. Loving it. Again. Games like that.
Like, yeah, it's just that the problem is those games only happen like once every 3 to 5 months.
Right. Which, you know, if you're strapped for cash, that's perfectly fine. But
yeah, but like
for a lot of people,
if you are not a casual, like a really casual player and like play, you know, a good amount, that's not gonna hold you over.
Right.
Which is a bummer, but you know.
Yeah. Oh well. So, but you know, this is definitely a GameCube like year though for them.
Oh, this is a, like, we got Pokken Tournament, which I can't really tell you its quality yet. Twilight Princess HD, it's a good game, but it's fucking support Twilight Princess.
Yep.
And then we got Star Fox, which I have no idea how it's going to be, honestly. And then Zelda, and then that's their year, probably. But we'll see. Anyway, I think that's about it.
Oh, all right.
Getting tired. I gotta be up at 9 o'clock.
Tired and hungry. This whole thing went sideways.
I'm gonna make a giant ass sandwich and tear into it.
And get some pizza. I'm gonna put a cake on it and I'm gonna sprinkle it with corn.
The pecornza? The poor cake?
Pecan. I'll work on a name overnight.
Pecorn? The pecorn. Oh, that sounds awful. Because corn
pecan.
Because corn on pizza is disgusting. So,
but if it's separated with cake,
that's what makes it work. Fucking.
I have a bad feeling. In like a couple years' time, we will be trying something with corn.
Oh, I have no doubt that Ray is already gonna get us to do the Oreo thing.
The Oreos, right.
Nacho cheese, like,
yeah.
Like, if we don't start Mario Party Party before we move, which we might have to wait until we move and then find two people. Question, would you be willing to go through Mario Party Party with us?
Fuck, man.
Is that a yes?
At the right time, sure. You know, all right. Fine. Damn it.
Great. Now I just need to find one more person up there that's willing, and we can wait until we move to do it.
Oh, God. Okay.
Gives me an excuse to put it off for as long as possible.
That'll be fun.
God.
I'll hate all of you, but it'll be
fun. He really enjoys those games. I do not. So
I love Mario Party. I just, you know, 50 turns of getting fucked around on that board.
This is literally just going to drive us insane. That's what it's going to do.
I mean, you know, those days are fun. You just have to, you have to plan them right. That's an all-day adventure.
Best part is if we like don't buy a new capture card by then, we're gonna have to like stop every hour.
Or like, oh god, no, we're not doing it with that. Nope. No.
Well, no, we have to stop every hour and 30 minutes to let it export, and so it doesn't corrupt, and then continue. So I mean, at least every hour and 30 minutes, we get like a 10 to 20 minute break.
I guess. Yeah, I don't know. But it'll be fun.
I know Ray and I are turning the spare bedroom up there into an office with like a full couch. So,
you guys think you can afford an extra?
Little... Yeah, like we've been looking at prices and like what the job we work pays up there, and yeah, we found that we can afford that. It's, you know,
all right.
It's gonna be like one of those things where it's just like, it's like, it's mainly gonna be on Ray and I to pay it, but like the difference between a 4-bedroom and a 5-bedroom is like $200.
Sure.
So, you know.
Fair enough. Okay.
Like if, you know. So yeah, just like how Ray and I are also gonna be paying for a separate internet connection.
Right. Yep. Smoky, salty caramel corn.
What the fuck?
Plan a movie night with friends and family just to have an excuse to make an extra large batch of this sweet meat salty corn treat.
Okay, we're stopping this now. Okay. You can find us on facebook.com/thegameraccess. You can find us on at Twitter at thegameraccess and twitch.tv/gameraccess. We stream every Friday. And there's a donation button, which would help us fund for a new capture card and equipment and possibly feeding ourselves.